In this session, I'll be talking about PICO study. Actually, this is a complex topic. I'm kindly familiar about the cardiac output, stroke volume, preload, contractility, and afterload for the better understanding of the PICO study. Okay. So, if you did not see my previous presentation, kindly go through it. If not, I'll be adding a link in the description box. Okay. So, now let's get into the topic PICO study. So, let's see the meaning of PICO. PICO means pulse counter cardiac output. It enables the assessment of the patient hemodynamic status. So after the PICO study, we will come to know that whether this patient needs fluid or we need to start any vasoactive drugs like noradrenaline, dopamine or dobutamine, or we need to start with any vasopressors like vasopressin. Okay, so this is a PICO. This is the meaning of PICO. We will see why you want to insert a PICO catheter for the patient or why you want a PICO reading from the patient. Okay, let's see. For example, you have somebody who is in shock. Okay, how do you know this patient is in shock? Then you know this by certain clinical parameters or the parameters you can measure. Okay, so what do you mean by shock? Shock means less oxygen supply or the less perfusion to the tissues. So organs are not getting perfused. That time you will call this is a shock. Okay. So I told if we want to know the patient is in shock, we need to know certain parameters. The parameters like we'll call like three clinical windows. In that first one is brain. So we will see the altered mental status of the patient. Whether the patient is drowsy, obstructed, confused, comatose, or delirious, whatever it may be, the change in mental status we will see. The second clinical window is kidney. So we will see the mainly the urine output. So if the patient is in shock, patient will have low urine output. So the third one we will see the skin. So skin will be cold, clammy, pale, and mottled. Mottled means you can see the different colors in different areas. In some areas you will see the pale, some areas you will be the red colors. So that is mottled. So these are the clinical windows you can see in a patient who is in shock. Okay, that is a clinical parameter. So next is the clinical measures. How you can measure some parameters and you know this patient is in shock. The parameters mainly BP, you can see hypotensive and heart rate, patient will be tachycardic, and you will see ABG for the acidosis and also for the lactate. So lactate will be high for the patient who is in shock. I said earlier, after assessing the patient by three clinical windows and measuring certain parameters like ABG, you end up in a decision that or conclusion that the patient is in shock. Then, this time the doctors will think about advanced hemodynamic monitoring, that is PICO, to find out whether this patient needs fluid or vasoactive drugs. Or the patient has some RV dysfunction, or means right ventricular dysfunction, or the tamponade. Okay, this can be measured by doing an echo. PICO is based on the two principles. First is thermodilution and the other one is pulse counter analysis. We'll see what is thermodilution. So before explaining the thermodilution, we will see the setup of PICO. Okay? In this setup, you can see a central venous axis, that is here. And also this central venous axis is connected with a three-way. And you can see a sensor here. Then which is connected to the syringe that contains called saline. And also, this obviously this will be attached to the monitor. Okay. Then again you can see one more transducer from here. That is for the arterial line. And it is connected to the femoral axis. Usually we are inserting in the femoral, PICO catheter in the femoral axis. Okay. So then here you can see one sensor also. Okay, so you can see two sensors. Here there is one and here is another one. So let's see the principle. So the principle is this. Once you push the cold saline through the central venous axis here, This sensor will measure the temperature of the saline. Then once you push into the circulation, the next sensor here, it will measure the difference in the temperature from the point you injected and the point it is recovered into the arterial system. Okay. Then also it will measure the time taken for doing it. The time taken means how fast we injected the saline. Okay. Or how much is the time taken that's to going through in the circulation. So this will measure the temperature difference and the time taken. It will measure the cardiac output. Okay. So we need to remember two things here. First one, the saline must be cold. Then only we will get the accurate cardiac output. And the second thing, we need to push fast. Okay. That are the two things we will see in this thermodilution principle. So the next principle is pulse contour analysis. Okay. You can see an arterial waveform here. So the area before the dichrotic notch. This is the area that I mark here. So this area is used to calculate the cardiac output. Okay. So in flow track mainly, they are using this principle. Okay. That is a simple machine. So only the advantage is only we need a arterial line to monitor to calculate a cardiac output. So if we have one arterial line, we can connect to flow track and we can get the cardiac output for the patients. Okay. In most of the time it's reliable. Okay. Like 80% we can say it's accurate and it's reliable. But in some cases, like the patient is in a severe shock or sepsis, or like multiple inotropes, or in vasopressors like vasopressin. Okay, in such condition, the more accurate is the calibrated system, that is the PICO. So like I explained before, this arterial, based on this arterial line or the arterial wave, it will give you a cardiac output. But you need to remember some things, like the main thing is to remember is the waveform should be regular and it should not be overdamped or underdamped. Okay, it should be regular like this. So it should not be like overdamped and underdamped. That then also it will give you a false cardiac output. And also, like, and the patient does not have any arrhythmias, that will also influence the cardiac output. So we'll see what happens in transpulmonary thermodilution. Okay. So actually it will not give you a continuous cardiac output, and we need to calibrate it like Q6th hourly or Q8th hourly as the patient condition changes. Like when we need to calibrate or when we need to repeat the cardiac output or the PICO, that means like when the patient condition is suddenly changed, the patient inotropic support or the vasopressor support that is rapidly increased, or the hemodynamic status of the patient is changed, the patient is getting deteriorated, that time we should know what happened and what went wrong to this patient. So in that cases, we need to repeat the PICO value. So here we will see, as I told before, like we will inject the false saline. Here in this graph, this axis, this vertical axis, it will give the temperature, and this horizontal axis, it will give the time. Okay. Here if you see that as it axis go up, the temperature is decreases. 37.1, 36.9, 36.7, 36.5. So we injected the cold saline here. So this saline is passing here, and when it reaches the circulation, that is here. So of course when it reaches the circulation, this is a cold saline. So it get mixed with the blood and the temperature decreases and coming down. And here the area, this measures, this is the arterial line sensor, this measures the difference in the temperature. So what you will get here? So you will get the volume of injection, that is 15 or 10 or 20. Okay. So here is 15 injected volume. Then you will get the time from to reach the cold saline from this point to this point. The time, that is 8 seconds, that will give here. Then the difference in the delta T here, that will tell you the difference in temperature, that is 0.54 degrees Celsius. Okay, that is here. That means here the temperature is different and here the temperature is different. So it is calculating and giving the temperature difference here, and also it will calculate the cardiac index or the cardiac output. Cardiac index means the cardiac output divided by the basal surface area, BSA, and it will give you the global end diastolic index, that is preload. I'll talk regarding this later, and it will give you the extra lung water index or the amount of fluid or the volume inside the lungs. Okay, it is an indication of the pulmonary edema, so it will give you all these values. So we will see some parameters measured in the PICO and also the normal values of each. Then we will have some thermodilution parameters here, and also we'll have some pulse counter parameters here. So let's see one by one. So first one is cardiac output. Everybody knows cardiac output means the amount of blood that is pumped by the heart in 1 minute. So that is a product of stroke volume and heart rate. So that is 4 to 8 liters per minute. Okay. Then from cardiac output, how you will get the cardiac index here? So that is so simple. The cardiac output divided by the body surface area. So how you will measure the body surface area? This is the equation for calculating the body surface area, that is BSA, that in meter square. If you want the cardiac output, you will take the square root of height of the patient and the weight of the patient divided by 3600, then you will get the body surface area. So you here you can see the preload parameter, that is GEDI, global end diastolic index, that will be 680 to 800 ml per meter square. So what do you mean by preload? Okay, preload means everybody knows that is the stretching force at the end of the diastole, the heart, that heart going in diastole, and that time the heart can relax the maximum or stretch maximum, that is called a preload. And the amount of volume or the blood that can accommodated during the preload, that is called a global end diastolic volume. Global means all the chambers of the heart. Okay, global end diastolic volume means the blood or the volume in all the 4 chambers of the heart, that is called a global end diastolic volume. And global end diastolic volume index means that is divided in the meter square and the body surface area, that is called a global end diastolic index or global end diastolic volume index. So we'll see what you mean by intrathoracic blood volume index. So that is the addition of the global end diastolic index plus the blood volume inside the pulmonary vessel. That means that is the volume of the 4 chambers of the heart plus the volume of the pulmonary blood vessels. So that is called the intrathoracic blood volume, that is in meter square, that you will call intrathoracic blood volume index. Okay, so next we will see extravascular lung water index, that is the amount of water content in the lungs. Okay, how much amount of water that is inside the lung. Okay, in this one, if measuring this one, the doctors will ask the lungs are wet or dry. Some other parameters also there, but mainly if the ELWI, that is 3 to 7 mls per kg, if it's more than this, okay, this indicate that the patient has pulmonary edema. So next one is PVPI, that is pulmonary vascular permeability index. Okay, what do you mean by permeability, vascular permeability index? Okay, let's see what do you mean by pulmonary edema. That means the fluid in the lungs. Okay, that is called pulmonary edema. The pulmonary edema can happen in 2 ways. Okay, first one is increase in the hydrostatic pressure or the fluid overload because of the system is congested. because the heart is not pumping well. Okay, maybe the backflow of the heart. Okay, all these things, the system get congested or the fluid overload, you can get the pulmonary edema. That is the first one. The second one, your hydrostatic pressure is okay and still you have pulmonary edema because of the increased permeability in the alveolar capillary membrane that I already discussed in one of my video, that is ARDS, because in the alveolar space, there the capillary membrane of the alveolar space getting damaged and there will be fluid exchange, means fluid will be leaking in the interstitial space, and that's how it's getting the pulmonary edema. That is the second one. Okay, so how we know that, and this is something related to congestion or related to ARDS. So that's why we will see this value, that is pulmonary vascular permeability index, that is 1 to 3. Okay, the values is between 1 to 3, the PVPI value between 1 to 3, it means that the patient has a hydrostatic pressure type of pulmonary edema, that is called cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Okay, if it is more than 3, then we can rule out that this is related to the permeability related, that is ARDS related pulmonary edema. So we will see next contractility. In contractility, we will see two main things, the cardiac function index and the global ejection fraction. Okay, so cardiac function index means the cardiac output divided by the global and diastolic volume. That means the amount of blood pumped in 1 minute, the volume divided by the at the end of the diastole, the amount of blood which is present in the all the chambers of the heart, then you will get the cardiac function. Okay, so next is ejection fraction, global ejection fraction. So the ejection fraction means that can be calculated by the stroke volume divided by end diastolic volume into 100. So you will get the percentage in EF. Okay, so stroke volume means the amount of blood that is pumped in each beat, that is stroke volume. End diastolic volume means that is the at the end of the diastole, the amount of blood that is present inside the heart. Then you will multiply it with the 100, then you will get the ejection fraction, that is to be 25 to 30%. Okay, not 60%, 65 or 75. Okay, so at least we'll need a minimum of 25 to 30%. So we'll be talking about now regarding the pulse counter parameters. So in the pulse counter parameters, we'll see about the flow, pulse counter cardiac output PCC, then ABP arterial blood pressure, heart rate, and stroke volume, that is 50 to 110 mL. Okay. So we already see the pulse counter analysis. In that we already discussed the area before the dichrotic notch, the area we will be calculating, and the area will calculated by the machine, and we will get a cardiac output. That is the principle we are used in the flow track. So now we will see something else regarding volume responsiveness, that is stroke volume variation and the pulse pressure variation. So SVV and the PVV, these are the indicators for the volume responsiveness in the PICO. Okay, so what do you mean by SCV, that is stroke volume variation? Variation here means something difference. Okay, the difference. Okay, what is the difference? So the difference between the stroke volume maximum and the stroke volume minimum divided by the mean stroke volume. So that means, what do you mean by stroke volume? The stroke volume means the amount of the blood that is pumped in each beat. So each beat the heart is pumping the blood. So yeah, these are the this is the graphical representation. So here we will take in one beat the already ejected the blood in one beat, that is here, that is the what is the maximum in one beat and what is the minimum. So we will take the difference divided by the average pumped in one beat. Okay, so here you see this is the maximum amount of blood that is pumped in one beat. So we will take the maximum minus the amount of blood which is pumped in a beat, that is the minimum volume. So see, you can see the graph is the small one. So we will take a difference. So SV maximum minus SV minimum divided by the average of this. Okay, then you will get the stroke volume variation. Okay, so in the stroke volume, how we can tell this is the volume responsiveness, we can measure. So if it is, so it is varying as per the inspiration. That means when the patient is on ventilator and the stroke volume and the pulse pressure, that is that varies with the inspiration and expiration. Okay, if the variation is less than 10%, then the patient is not volume deficient. That means up to 10, we can tell the patient has a good amount of volume. So no need to give the volume for this patient. Okay. Means if SVV less than 10%, we can tell the patient is not volume deficient. Patient has the adequate volume in the body. So if it varies from 10 to 15%, then tell that either you are volume deficient, okay, the patient needs volume, or you have the right ventricular dysfunction. Okay, again, if SVV is less than 10%, that value tells us that this patient does not need any volume. Okay, patient has the adequate volume. If more than 10 to 15, it tells that this patient is volume deficient, and or maybe this patient not only the volume deficient, or maybe the patient has right ventricular dysfunction. Okay, that the machine cannot tell you. It can, we can identify this by doing an echo if the patient has RV dysfunction. And one more thing, how you can say, or how much accurate this SVV and PPV. Okay, so there are some checklists, like basic checklist, then only we can tell this value is accurate. First of all, the patient should be on ventilator, and the patient should not be breathe over the ventilator, means should be sedated or paralyzed, and the tidal volume which we are giving at least 80 to 10 ml per kg. Then the patient should not have any other arrhythmias and should not rule out before like any significant RV dysfunction. Okay, these are the 5 criterias or the checklist we will tell to be the SVV and the PPV which is showing in the monitor to be accurate. Okay, so again, okay, we need to follow some checklist, then only the SVV or the PPV will give you the correct value. Okay, then only we can find out the volume responsiveness of the patient. So what are the things? The patient should be on ventilator, and the patient should not be, should be sedated or the paralyzed, or the tidal volume at least 80 to 10 ml per kg, and the patient should not have any arrhythmias and should not have any significant RV dysfunction. Okay, so all these are okay. Okay, if checklist are maintaining, then you can tell this SVV value is correct. Okay, if any of these parameters is dearranged, like patient has already, this patient is breathing over the ventilator, all these things, then you will get a false result of SVV. So you cannot predict. So this patient is volume deficient or not. So here the last one, we will talk about the afterload parameter, that is SVRI, that is systemic vascular resistance index, that will be around 1700 to 2400 dynes per meter square. Okay, so here we will see the resistance, SVRI. SVRI means this is a systemic vascular resistance or the total peripheral resistance. Means the systemic vascular resistance, that is refers to the resistance to the blood flow offered by the all the systemic vasculature. Okay, we see in the afterload. Okay, this afterload means, okay, the When the left ventricle has to overcome this systemic vascular resistance to pump the blood. So that is called that force by the left ventricle is called afterload. So there will be some resistance in the systemic vasculature. So what do you mean by systemic vasculature? That is the aorta, that is a big blood vessel, then arteries, arterioles, then it's branched to form blood capillaries. Okay, so the total resistance there, okay, that is called a systemic vascular resistance. Okay, so it doesn't, this values does not much influence this. So we don't see these numbers. Okay, we need to only to identify. So we need to only to think in the mind that if we are giving the vasopressin or the vasopressors, the cardiac output increases or not. Okay, okay. If there is any difference in these numbers, okay, if any increase in these numbers is influencing the cardiac output or not. So now we are going to see the algorithm, okay, how we can apply this in clinical settings. Okay, so we know cardiac output, cardiac index, how it's calculated, how is the preload, what is preload, what do you mean by GDI, intrathoracic blood volume, then what do you mean by extra lung water index and cardiac function index, EFI, ejection fraction. We know the normal values. Okay, it's better to learn the normal values, then it will be very easy to see the abnormalities in the PICO study. Okay, then heart rate, stroke volume, then we know the volume response, how we will find out the patient is volume deficient. If it's more than 10%, we will tell is a volume deficient, or then afterload. Okay, so we'll see the algorithm next. So this is the algorithm the doctors are using to read a PICO. And we'll see, this look like a very complex algorithm, but no need to study, just to understand what is the principle and how they are using it. Okay, so this is a cardiac index, the normally that is 3 to 5. So here it is less than 3. So what happened? Then if the patient got a cardiac index is less than 3, means cardiac output is low. So we need to find out why it is low. So here we will see the global end diastolic index or the global end diastolic volume, that is also less than 700. That means that is a normally 680 to 800. Okay, so this is also less. Then of course, if it is, this is less than intrathoracic blood volume also less, that is also less than 850, that is the normal is 850 to 1000. So next the parameter we will see, how is the lungs. Okay, so that is also less than 10, the normal is 3 to 7. Okay, so we can see here the patient is dehydrated in this case. Okay, cardiac index or the cardiac output is less than 3 because of the global end diastolic volume, that is also low. Patient is dehydrated, and also extra vascular lung volume, the volume inside the lung also is, it is less than 10. What we will give in this case, we will give the volume for the patient or the fluid for the patient, that is V plus. Okay, so in this case we will give the volume. So let's see here. So this is cardiac output is less. Okay, in this case you can see GEDI, it is more than normal, normally 680 to 850. Then you can see intrathoracic blood volume, that is more than 850, that is normally 850 to 1000. Then you can see the lungs, lung volume, that is less. Okay, so the lungs are little bit dry here, but there is volume. So no need to give the volume here because the patient has already the volume in the heart. So what we need to give here is, we need to start with the inotropes or the vasoactive drugs to maintain the cardiac output here. Okay, then next see this opposite side here. Okay, see here you can see this end diastolic volume, that is more than 700, and 850 intrathoracic blood volume, that is also 850. And also you can see this here, This one, that is a lung volume also, it is more than 10. Okay, so there is fluid volume, there is volume in the lungs, and also there is volume in the heart. Okay, but these volumes are not influencing, not increasing the cardiac output. So what we will give in this case, okay, we need to increase the cardiac output somehow. So we will start the inotropes here, then too much volume here. So what we will give? We will give the diuretics, that is E minus. We will decongest the system. Okay. Likewise here also. Likewise you can read here also. Okay. So the same principle. Okay. Fluid is extra lung water index is more. Okay. And the other volumes also more. You can decongest the system. Okay. Otherwise you can give the flows. Okay. This is the principle that the doctors are using. So this is the same way you can read here also. So this is a screenshot of a flow track machine. Okay, that is the principle is pulse counter analysis. Okay, here you will get two things. Okay, because this is we need only the arterial line for this. Okay, only the arterial line. So this is a minimal invasive technique to find out the cardiac output. So the patient only has the anterior line. So here you will get two things: cardiac index or the cardiac output 3.9, which is normal. Normally 3 to 5 liter per meter square. So this is normal. Then you will get the SVV. SVV, I already talked regarding SVV. SVV is more than 10. The patient need volume. Okay, and volume deficient. If more than 10% the patient need volume, and if less than 10, the patient has the adequate volume or the volume responsive. So here the thing, here in this one you can see SVV is 2, so it's okay. The patient has adequate volume and the cardiac output is okay. It's maintaining 3.9, so this is normal. So first of all, this is a volume view in a flow track. Okay, so you will see here cardiac output, it is low, borderline. So 3 to 5 is the normal, 3 to 5 liter per meter square. Then you have SVV here. So SVV means volume response. We need to see the volume response of the patient. More than 10, patient is volume deficient. So it is less than 10, so 4% only. 4%, so can tell nothing to do with the volume. Patient has the adequate volume. So then you will see here something called lung water volume. Here that is 11.3. Normally it is like 3 to 7. So the lung has the fluid or lungs are wet. And something you will, so here you will see EGEDI, the global and diastolic volume, that is also little bit high, like 680 to 850. So it is 780. So nothing to not worry about the volume. Here the heart has the volume, and although lung is also overloaded. Then you will see here GEF. GEF, it is 14. It is 14 only here, GEF. So you will see this ejection fraction is only 14. The normal is 25% to 35%. So ejection fraction is 14 means the heart is not pumping or the function is decreased. Okay. And because of that, lung volume is getting increased. So you hear, in this case, you can tell that there is a heart failure. So to rule out more, you need to do an echo to get more clinical evidence. Then only you can just diagnose. But here, from this values, you can say, because this ejection fraction is less here and also the lung volume is getting increased, so you can tell probably this patient is in heart failure. This is the end of the video. I hope everybody understood the PICO, how to read a PICO and how to interpret a PICO study, all these things. So if you have any doubt, you can put the doubt in the comment section below. So if I'm able, I'll do it. I'll answer your questions. Signing off, I'm Sandhya here, working as a critical care nurse. So we'll be back with another video, and so stay tuned. Thank you for watching.